So in the last class, we had just begun analyzing the electrodynamic lumped parameter model of an acoustic transducer. Where we left in the last class was that we had identified some breakpoints or resonance points. Specifically, there was an electrical resonance between RE and LE, and that was happening at around 1820 hertz. That's what we calculated. Then there was a resonance as a consequence of CM and MM, and that was happening at 89 hertz. And then an acoustic resonance because of MA and RA, that was occurring at 717 hertz or something like that. The other thing we had done was that we had decomposed this transfer function V naught prime over V naught in terms of U coil over V times V naught prime over U coil. So what we will do today is we will develop a board plot for the first ratio U coil over V and see how it changes as frequency changes. And then we'll also develop a board plot for the second transfer function V naught prime over U coil. And then once we have these two board plots together, then we'll add them up and see how the overall transfer function of the overall transducer looks like. As we develop this relation, you may want to remember that an ideal transducer should have a very flat transfer function over a range of frequencies. So the wider that flat area is from an ideal standpoint, the better it is from a listening purposes. The other feature of a good transducer would be that not only it should be flat, but it should be as high as possible. Because what that means is that if I send in a little amount of electrical energy, it gets converted into more and more of sound. Typically, the efficiency of very good acoustic transducers does not exceed 1 or at the most, if you're really smart, 2%. So that should give you some overall perspective. The overall efficiency of a sound system or a transducer hardly exceeds 1 or 2%. So we will start developing a relation for U coil over V, V naught prime over U coil. So we'll do this in two steps. Step one is we are going to do V naught prime over U coil. Now, when I look at this circuit, my V naught prime is the voltage across this acoustic resistor, RA over AC square. And U coil is basically just the voltage across the transformer after the electrical circuit, right? And the current in the mechanical circuit is essentially force, and the current in electrical circuit is obviously current. So when I look at this circuit, what I infer is that to get this ratio, all I have to consider is basically the element MA times AC square and RA over AC square, right? That's the only thing I have to worry about. So the equivalent circuit is something like this. So this is MA times AC square, and this is RA over AC square. My input voltage will be in this case U coil, and what I will be measuring and what I am interested in is V naught prime. So this, just for sake of simplicity, is something like this. I just simplified the notations, right? And if I compute impedance, if I compute the impedance and I try to find the ratio, the relationship which I get is V naught prime over U coil comes to is complex frequency times capacitance, which is I have noted as M times R over 1 plus S M R. So now I construct a Bode plot. So on my horizontal axis, I have logarithm of omega, and in my vertical axis, I have decibels. Omega tends to 0. How will the Bode plot look like? As omega, or that is S, which is j omega, as omega goes towards 0, the low frequency asymptote, how will it look like? It will go through the origin, and it will be a straight line with a positive slope of 20 decibels per decade. And once it crosses a certain threshold, then as omega goes towards infinity, what happens? This ratio essentially converges to 1, right, at infinity. So log of infinity, log of 1 is 0. So the high frequency asymptote is something like this. And this, what is this value? 0. 0 decibels. What is this break point? This point? 1 over MR. Right. What was the 717 hertz? We had calculated. Okay. So this is my Bode plot for V naught prime over U coil. Let's call this figure A. So we have finished developing a Bode plot for the second portion, which is this. Now we will do for this one. In the second step, step 2, what we are going to compute is a Bode plot for U coil over V. In the last class, we had found that there was a resonance happening at 89 hertz, right? So below 89 hertz, U coil over V is, this is my V and this is U coil. Below 89 hertz, what is going to happen is that most of the current is going to pass through CM, the mechanical inductance. The impedance due to MM, RM and all these things will be extremely high. For F less than 89 hertz, my equivalent circuit is going to look like CM, and that's my U coil. Why did I neglect LE in this circuit? I dropped out LE in this circuit. On the electrical side, I have not included LE. Why have I done that? LE becomes important as we had calculated after 1820 hertz. Below 1820, RE is going to dominate, right? So I can neglect the impact of LE for F less than 89 hertz. The Bode plot in this case is going to look like how will it look like? It will be a straight line slanting positively, and the slope will be 20 dB per decade. And this is 89 hertz. Okay? So now I have to go from 89 to, what is the next breakpoint? 700 and? 17 hertz, right? So for F, hertz is larger than, is smaller than F, and that is less than 717 hertz. So my electrical circuit is going to look like, so now I will have the capacitor mm. And both these capacitors are going to be, because very low current is going to pass through this inductor, because I am above 89 hertz, and the capacitors will become active.
Then the last word for you, sir, why the upper line, why the horizontal line was a 0 dB line?
Which one? In an asymptotic sense.
So like if you draw individually all the like S and then MR and then.
So as S becomes infinite, as S becomes infinite, the numerator is becoming more and more, as S tends to infinity, numerator and denominator, they become more and more equal. So their ratio goes to 1, regardless of the values of M and R. So this is my reduced circuit for this frequency range 89 hertz to 717 hertz. Again, this is V and this is U coil. So my board plot in this case, and as frequency goes higher and higher, the impedance offered by these, so I get my, this was my original line going up to 89 hertz, then I have a negative slope, and the negative slope is 20 dB per decade, and this is going up to 717 hertz. So again, on the horizontal axis, I'm plotting logarithm of omega, and on the vertical axis, I have decibels. And this is still U coil over V. So we know response below 89 hertz, response above 89 hertz up to 717 hertz. We could ask ourselves a question that what happens at 89 hertz specifically. So that is what we will. Once, if we know the answer to that, we will know this value. How many dB is at 89 hertz? So that is what we will find. So what happens when F equals 89 hertz? So at 89 hertz, on the other side, above the, beyond the transformer, the circuit will look like, there will be a capacitor. There is an inductor which is mm, capacitance is, yeah, so I have capacitance of mm, inductance of cm, and resistance of 1 over rm. So in a general sense, I am just calling them LCR. And when L and C resonate, and they are in parallel, their overall impedance, does it go to zero or does it go to infinite when they are parallel? If it goes to infinite, we will see that. If we just find the impedance of this block, Z block, is 1 over SL plus SC inverse equals SL 1 plus S square CL, right? So at resonance, the impedance offered by this entire block is infinite, because 1 plus S square CL becomes 0. Right? So no current is going at resonance. When an inductor and capacitor, they are in parallel and they resonate, no current flows through them. And all the current goes through the resistor. Our original question was that what is happening at 89 Hertz? What that means is all current is going through the resistance. So just at 89 Hertz, my equivalent circuit is UQL. For this one, if I actually compute the value, I get UQL over V equals 1 over 9 times 162 over 162 plus 8. I'm just basically plugging in the values which we had recorded earlier. So this comes to 0.1059. In decibels, it becomes, so if this is W1, then W1 becomes 20 dB 0.1059 log minus 20 dB above. So I go back and modify this graph and I make this peak value minus 20 dB. One note of correction, in all these cases, the value here is a resistor. Below 1820 Hertz, it's going to be a resistor because that is larger than the inductor and both are in series. So this also needs correction. So I apologize. So now we have figured out a board plot from 0 Hertz at 89 Hertz. This value becomes minus 20 decibels. Beyond 89 Hertz, again it will start rolling off at a slope of minus 20 dBs per decade. So our next one is for the range 717 Hertz to 1820 Hertz. So again, looking at making judgments which components to include, which components should not be included, my equivalent circuit looks like this. The only thing I have is mm. This is my UQL. Is everyone clear why this is the case? The board, basically what this picture tells me is that the board plot will not change its characteristics beyond 717 Hertz also. The slope will continue to fall at the same rate, the value. So my modified board plot becomes ...89 Hertz, and it keeps on going till 1820 Hertz. That's my omega. This is in decibel, and what I am plotting is UQL over V. This is up to 1820 Hertz. Finally, for F greater than 1820 Hertz, I get, so here I have a resistance and a capacitor. Above 1820 Hertz, what is the change going to happen? Inductor becomes active. The electrical inductor becomes active. And the slope of this line will be what? It will have a slope of minus 40 decibels. Because now I have two, okay. Earlier we had seen that if I put a capacitor and inductor in series, which is the same case here, the slope becomes minus 40. So I will go back and modify, actually I will make a new one. Clearly this figure is not to scale. And this value is minus 20 decibels. So again, this is U coil over V. We started with a fairly, not a very complex circuit, but a fairly complex circuit. But just by identifying the breakpoints, decomposing our transfer function into small manageable ratios. We have been able to plot the board plots for all the components which are going to play a role. So now what I am going to do is, I am going to find the board plot for the entire function, which is essentially a sum of those two board plots. My final board plot will look like something like this. So this final board plot will be a plot of V naught prime over V. What is this slope? The slope of the first segment? 40 degrees. And this is 20 decibels. And this guy is minus 40 decibels per degree. Looking at this picture, what conclusions do you draw?
They should operate under 89 to 770.
So that is the first thing, that from 89 to 717 hertz, you can use it and whatever is going in, it will be faithfully reproduced at the same level. Output response will be same, it will have a flat response. Now in this entire analysis, I mean we have plotted it up to infinite hertz, this range could be as high. But as we were developing the lumped parameter model of the entire system, we had made certain assumptions. And the most central assumption was my size of the transducer or radiating area shall not exceed lambda over 2 pi. Right. So I have not done the calculation, but the validity of this board plot is only good to the extent that whatever, let us say lambda over 2 pi comes to 1200 hertz. I have not calculated, but you can go and calculate what that number is. So this board plot can be relied upon only up to that particular frequency. That is the second thing. The first one is that I have a flat frequency response from 89 to 717 hertz. If everything else is good, then I can rely, I can use this in this range. The second thing is that I may have to restrict the usage of this board plot at a cutoff frequency which corresponds to lambda over 2 pi. So we have to find. The third thing in lumped parameter model is, especially from mechanical standpoint, is that I am assuming that the masses are rigid. I have a diaphragm and it just moves like this. Now in reality, when you have any membrane or any structure, it has its own modes. It could be that the diaphragm starts breaking up, meaning that it starts exhibiting its own modes at 300 hertz, 400 hertz, I don't know. If that is the case, then that is another word of caution. that this particular board plot has its validity as long as rigid masses remain rigid. We have assumed that the diaphragm is infinitely stiff and it does not bend and twist as it moves back and forth. So someone, while this analysis is done at a more detailed and a refined level, someone has to go and do a modal analysis of the diaphragm using some finite element methods and stuff like that, and figure out what are the modes at which the diaphragm starts exhibiting its own. It is no longer rigid. So that is the third thing.
In industry, what is preferred?
In what sense?
So like a lumped parameter system or?
No, lumped parameter model, it gives you a guideline. If, because it's a relatively straightforward way. Just doing the diaphragm, finding modes of diaphragm, all it will tell you is that the diaphragm is going to have. So when you do, this is your diaphragm, right? And then here you have a voice coil. I'm exaggerating. Can everyone see this or can you see it? So, and then there is a suspension here. So it's like a spring. So when you do, and then there is also a suspension here. So when you do modal analysis of this using finite element method, you model, you make, create elements on the spider, you create elements on the surround, on the cone, everywhere. You have elements and then you do modal analysis. Naturally, the first mode which the finite element analysis shows, it will spit out, will show, will be what? It will be equivalent to your mechanical resonance, K over M, right? So there's a K associated with these springy elements and then there's the overall mass. So the first mode will be, let's say M1. Will be, I don't know what we calculate, K over M, 75 hertz, right? So it will calculate it is 75 hertz. So what that means is that this entire structure, and when you draw the mode shapes, you will see that finite element will predict that this entire thing moves up and down in the modal analysis. That is a pistonic or a rigid body motion. That is fine. At maybe some other mode, M2, what it will do is that it starts, instead of moving like that, the cone also has a propensity, the structure, to do this, right? I mean, it can move like this, it can also do this because it is hinged here. But at a higher frequency, so this can do this. So this is called rocking mode. This is going too deep into transducer design. So we are not developing sound systems in this class, but since you asked. But still higher, what starts happening is, maybe in the next class I'll show you some pictures, that this cone, it no longer remains rigid. So it starts doing, suppose this is a cone surface, it starts doing something like this. And then you have to, this is 3D, when you do a 3D picture of this, 3D, if I look at it from the top side, you will see something like this. So some part is coming up, some part is going down and so on and so forth. What that means is that the cone is no longer rigid. So at frequencies above that particular number, the value or the faith which I will have in the predictions of my lumped parameter model will be limited. They may still be valid in a quantitative sense, but they will still, qualitative sense, but they will have a limited validity. So, but again, we start typically from lumped parameter model because it gives you an overview, how the system is going to behave. And it's very easy to tweak specific parameters and adjust this flat range, right? If I want my flat range from, let's say, 40 hertz to 1000 hertz, suppose the requirement is that I want my transducer, particular transducer, to start working from 40 hertz to 300, 400 hertz, then I can use this kind of approach to figure out what are the optimum parameters. How much is my moving mass going to be? Once I know that, I can figure out the size and the thickness of my cone in different parts, and I can design them. I know from this approach what is going to be the stiffness of my system. So then accordingly, once I have that target number, I can design the shape of my spider, shape of the surround, and figure out how to get that particular number. It also tells me what is the value of BL going to be, which helps me in design the magnet. The same model also tells me what is going to be the optimum value of RE, which helps me design the voice coil. It also tells me what is going to be the optimum value of AC, radiating area, and that essentially helps me understand how big my transducer has to be. So there's a very strong value in using this approach in figuring out the overall design at a course level. And once I have figured out the course level important parameters of the design, then I go part by part and design them at a more refined level. So that is the value of this system overall, at a system level, modeling the entire system. So what we will do again in next 10, 15, at the most 20 minutes is, we will change, play with a couple of parameters in this circuit and see how it impacts the overall response of the system. So that will again give you a flair, the value of this particular way of modeling transducers. What we had assumed in this particular model was that the transducer is mounted in, how is it mounted?
Infinite baffle.
So you have an infinitely large wall, it's mounted there, the wall is rigid, it does not move back and forth, and the speaker is radiating sound outside in the positive half plane. Now in a real application, you don't have infinite baffle. So in a lot of conventional systems, you may have seen big boxes, right, where they mount these speakers. So what we'll try to find out is, what does that do to the performance? Transducer in a box or sealed enclosure. So I have a box. And this diaphragm is moving in and out. And let's say the volume of this box is V0. Physically, we have talked about this earlier. What does a volume do? Right? It acts as a spring. So I have this entire circuit, and the stiffness of this spring is V0 over rho C square. And if I have to remove that transformer, I also put an AC square in the denominator. So this is acting like a inductor. This inductor is going to be parallel. Will it be in parallel to the mechanical inductor or in series to the mechanical inductor, which is the spring? It will be in parallel. If you add two springs in series, the overall stiffness, does it go up or does it go down? It goes down, right? If you have the two springs in parallel, the overall stiffness goes up. So what this box is doing is, it's going to increase the overall stiffness. Physically, I'm trying to explain. All I have to do here is, I have to add one more element. I'll just erase some things for, so that I can put in more stuff. I will put one more compliance member, and this will be CB, compliance of the box. That's all I'm doing, right? And the compliance of the box is this value. To make my life simpler for analysis purposes, I can assume that CB equals CM. It makes things simpler. What that does is that my FM, mechanical resonance, it goes up. By how much? Basically, if CB equals CM, then I can add these two up together, right? CM and CB, I can just make the overall thing as 2 CM. My mechanical resonance will go up by a factor of root 2. My overall system response will be, this was my original curve, hertz. Basically what I will get is, I will get another parallel line . This is 89 times root 2. That is, this is my omega log omega decibels. So the dark black line, solid black line, is the original line. This dotted line, it corresponds to the performance of the transducer in a box whose stiffness is same as the stiffness of the original transducer. So if that is the case, then this gap AA prime is off by half octave. An octave is a factor of 2, right? So it's half octave. Root 2 times root 2 is. This drop of 6 decibel. So basically what you have done is, once you put the system in a box, you have reduced the operating bandwidth of the transducer at an optimal level. So that helps you understand why in conventional systems will in boxes which are very large, so that the additional stiffness exerted by the box onto the whole system is as low as possible. If my stiffness becomes large and large, this A prime moves towards point D. A prime moves towards B. So if I have to bring it closer to A, then I have to keep on increasing the size of the box. So that's why in a lot of institutions, in auditoriums, I mean, sometimes they have boxes as big as a room itself, sometimes. I mean, the height of the room is something comparable to the height of the box. So that is the motivation. We'll do one or two. Another one is what they call a ported box. We have talked about this ported box earlier in one of the earlier lectures. We'll again revisit it in context of the parts which we have developed. So I have my original transducer and then I have a port. So its length is L, its area is AT. What this does is, it adds the following elements to the circuit. There's a radiative impedance, so it is V naught over rho naught C square A C square. This is basically the stiffness of the box. And then rho naught L over A B times A C square. This is the acoustic mass which we had talked about earlier. Port sides act as acoustic masses. So in this circuit, what I am going to do is, I am going to add this additional circuit. This value, the inductance is V naught over rho C square AC square, and this is rho naught L over AP times AC square. AC square will be a numerator.
Since impedance becomes by A square.
Okay. It's an LC circuit. Now I am interested in two parameters. One is whatever is the volume velocity in physical sense, sound coming out of the port, That is one thing I'm interested in. The other thing which I'm interested in is whatever, what is the spectrum of sound as it comes out of the speaker. There are two sources which are radiating energy. So this is V, I call it V cap. Sound is coming out of the speaker, that is one surface. Sound is also coming out of the port, that's another surface. I'm interested in both of them. And in a very qualitative sense, we'll try to see how things change at resonance, below resonance, above resonance, and so on and so forth. So the first thing is that this additional circuit has its own depth. So it resonates, which is there in blue. Because the capacitor and inductor are in parallel, are in series, their overall impedance goes down to zero.
Sure.
When they are parallel, their impedance shoots to infinity. So when that happens, almost all current goes through this loop. So at resonance of this LC circuit, you will have a peak in terms of dBs field, but it will be in a narrow band around the resonance itself. So one, at LC resonance, all current goes through port. I'm putting port in parenthesis because I'm using mixing current with port. Second, think about it physically. What happens when frequencies are extremely low? When you have very low frequencies, meaning below mechanical resonance, when the speaker is moving out, there will be a vacuum which will get created in the, or low pressure condition which will get created in the box. And air will come in from the port and it will go in. You have a suction condition happening when speaker is moving out. So the transducer is trying to generate a positive pressure and port is trying to generate just the inverse of it. And both these things will almost cancel out each other at low frequencies. So the output at low frequencies will be negligible. Point about frequency is important because at higher frequencies, the time it will be required, the inertia effects will become important enough so that the time required for air to come in and compensate for the pressure will not be large enough. So at higher frequencies, this will not happen, but at low frequencies, this will happen. At low frequencies, very low output.
But this case will happen with all sorts of speakers.
All sorts of speakers. What is low frequency depends on the system parameters. But it is not specific to this particular transducer. But it will happen in any case. Third, at mechanical resonance implying CM and MM, when they resonate, the overall impedance we had seen was infinite, right? Because CM and MM are in parallel. What that means is, physically, that at that point, the piston does not move much. Even though current is going through, there is impedance, then it will not move much if the impedance is infinite. So the piston does not move much and all the energy it gets channelized through the port. All the energy gets channelized through the port. So the volume velocity at mechanical resonance of the port is very high. So you can design the system in such a way that the at resonance the volume the contribution of port is high at specific frequencies where the transducer itself is not contributing, and at other frequencies where port does not do much, your transducer plays an important role. So what this system does is its performance is still not as great as that of an infinite baffle. But in reality, you cannot have an infinite baffle. And if you want to get closer and closer to infinite baffle, you need very large boxes, which is not practical. So people have started using, in a lot of cases, ports. Even in small sound systems, boom boxes, which you may have, you may see a small tube going inside. It's a port. There's a volume inside, and there's a port inside. That's what it is, physically. The third example we'll consider is increased mass. By mass, I physically mean mass of the cone, mass of void swell, part of the mass of the these springs. What happens if I increase them without increasing or changing other engineering parameters, specifically resistance, stiffness and all those numbers? When you increase your mass, your resonance is going to come down. So that's my original curve. When my mass goes up, then in theory my curve looks like this. What I get here is that at a reduced resonance I get some extra decibels. This is about, if I increase my mass by, if I double it, then I get an enhancement of about 3 decibels, which is significant. My overall broadband response goes down by 6 dB, but my operating width becomes a little larger. My operating width becomes a little wider. So this is a good story as well as a bad story. Good story because my operating width has become a little larger. So what I can do is that to get to the same sound performance pressure level, I can put in more power and I can get more energy, more sound energy for a wider band. The bad thing is that I have to put in more power. This is what I wanted to cover in today's lecture. I also wanted to quickly recap on an assignment problem which I had given in one of the earlier assignments. And the question was, I think that merits a little bit explanation. The question was that if I have a ball of radius R naught, this was in assignment 5, and it's pulsating uniformly and it emits an energy such that at radius R1 the total pressure, not pressure, the power output is something like this. Right. This corresponds to T time period. What I am plotting here is power per unit area. This value is 3 times positive number m, this value is negative m. And one of the questions was that if I have this graph, what is the phase difference between pressure, outward going pressure and velocity waves? What is the phase difference, phase angle of the outward going wave? So there were some questions on that particular, this particular part of the problem. So I just wanted to capture that. For starters, what is the average power in this case?
Modem into 4 pi r
square. M times 4 pi r square. 4 pi r square because this is power per unit area. Some people miss that. We know that power per unit area, we had developed this relation, is half of real PU star plus half of real PU E 2 J omega T. Now before I go more into detail, I just wanted to, just by looking at this picture, we can make some inferences that given that there is minus 1, this graph for power is not symmetric. If it was perfectly symmetric, then the average power will be 0. right? What that means is that it will not have any resistive element in it. This is a combination of some resistive element and it's an inductive or capacitive element in the overall system. And we know that for a point source or a source of finite size, as it emits radially into far field, there's a real component in its impedance and there's an imaginary component. This asymmetric function is a consequence of the presence of real and imaginary components. So this picture should give us some idea how to figure out what is the phase relation. If it was perfectly symmetric, then the phase would have been either minus 90 or plus 90. Right? If it was, everything was zero or positive, then the phase would have been zero because it is purely resistive. The expectation is to figure out what is the phase difference and finding it an actual number based on the information provided. So this is, I developed this further, real P plus over R1 E minus J omega R1 over C, that's my P, times U star, so that is P plus star over R1 E J omega R1 over C times 1 over Z star, right, plus half. So now I will expand the second component. This one is E plus over R1 E minus J omega R1 over C times U. So it's P plus E minus J omega R1 over C over R1. U is basically P over Z, right? So I 1 over Z, and then I have E 2 J omega T 1 over Z star is 1 over, what's that relation? Rho naught C minus 1 over J omega R 1 rho naught. 1 over Z is this entire thing, there's no negative sign, but there's a positive sign. So Z star is just basically I put a minus. So I plug this up here. I know that power over area is also, the other thing is it 3m, 2m, 2m? This is also power over area, right? Sum this graph. The average power is m, which is, and the transient component is 2m cosine 2 pi t over t. So I put all this in this original relation and what I get is m plus 2m cosine 2 pi t over t equals my first component, which is real p u star half. So that gives me p plus over R1 square 2. Why do I do that? Because P plus times P plus star modulus gives me the modulus. Real 1 over rho naught C minus 1 over J omega rho naught R1 plus. So now I am writing the transient component 2R1 square. Now, before I expand, I just wanted to make a small comment. I am assuming when I am developing this relation, the transient portion of, I am assuming that Z is modulus times E J phi. I can assume that. So with that assumption, I get 1 over Z E J 2 phi, I think this is this, minus 2 omega R1 over C plus 2 omega t. Okay?
So, in the second term, now have you taken p plus mod as common? Because, it will be p times u, and p times u is p plus y, not the mod of p plus y.
Say that again.
So, it's p plus.
P plus times p plus.
Yes, so it's not of mod of p plus y, it's p plus y.
P plus star.
Second term does not contain star. I am assuming, okay, yes. So, as I said, I am assuming that P plus is P plus is what I get is, so I have two sides in the equation, and now what I'll do is I'll just equate the steady state part with the steady state part as the first step. So let's call this equation 1. So comparing steady state parts, I get
It won't have 1 by mod z.
I'm just talking about the first part.
No, sir. The second term you have written.
Yes, you're right. See. So, comparing only the steady state parts on both sides, I get times 1 over rho naught c. Okay. So, my p plus becomes 2 r1 square rho naught c times m. So now I use this equivalence, put it in transient, and then equate the two transient portions sides. So what I get is, using that exercise, 2 m cosine 2 pi t over t equals m r1 square and 2, they get cancelled out, rho naught c real portion of this entire thing, exponent j 2 phi minus 2 omega r1 over c plus 2 omega t over z.